Good morning, Harvest. How's everyone doing today? Come on. Yeah, there we go. This is the amp up to worship. My name is Ramirez. I serve as the campus pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus, and it's so great to be back in God's house with God's people on God's day, fresh off of an awesome worship night. So really hoping that we can carry that into this morning's worship. And if this is your first time joining us today, I want to extend a very special welcome to you. And just know that you're amongst the welcoming people. I'm one of them. So I will be in the lobby after service in our welcome section. I would love the opportunity to meet you and to just see how I could serve you during your time here at Harvest. Harvest, in our continuing efforts to care for the people in our church, we have this thing called the Harvest Bible Chapel app, and many of you have it on your phone. So if you don't mind grabbing your phone and checking in right now, it not only lets us know that you're here today, but it also allows us an opportunity to care for you through prayer, and also you can find out what's happening here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And speaking of prayer, we're going to lift up another like-minded church today, that being City Line Church, which is a church that we planted about 2 years ago. We're going to pray for them and their pastor, Mohan Zachariah. But before we do that, I want to take the time to acknowledge our students who are returning to school in a few days for some of you. And so if you are a student or a teacher or an administrator, do you mind just standing? And we want to pray for you. So if you have someone near you that's standing, just point your hands towards them as we pray for them and City Line Bible Church. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for what you are doing in the lives of our children. And we thank you for our administrators and teachers who are training them up. And so, God, I just pray that you will protect them, that you will give them wisdom. Lord, I pray, your word tells us that you are our protector. And so, God, we're asking that you protect them. And as our students go out into this world, may they be a beacon of light for you. Lord, we thank you for our students, our teachers, and administrators. And Lord, we're thankful for City Line Bible Church and everything that they are doing in their community. Will you continue to provide all the needs of their church? May their staff not grow weary in doing well. And God, we thank you for this opportunity to serve you this morning with our worship. And so God, your word tells us that you are with us right now. Lord, we want to feel your presence this morning. Will you open up hearts today to receive your word, but will you also encourage us this morning? Let every burden be left at the doors and every chain be broken this morning. God, we thank you and we ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. All right, now everyone stand to your feet and let's worship the Lord together.
Our confidence is in you, Lord, yeah. Let's sing this together. We have every confidence that he is faithful. Yes, our testimony is the living proof. And if you doubt the evidence that he is able, open your eyes or people get ready. Just build an altar, drench it. Drench it in water. Stand back and wonder.
Transition from eyes of seeing what we see right in front of us to eyes of faith. We want to put our eyes on the Lord. And I was reminded today of a verse that says, is anything too hard for him? Is anything too hard for him? So whatever it is you're going through, just kind of bring that to mind right now. And let's start putting eyes of faith on. We know that he holds all power. He created the universe. So what can he not do? What can he not change? And I was also thinking of the woman in the scriptures and in the gospels who came after Jesus. She had a discharge of blood and she reached out for him and she touched his garment and she was instantly healed because of her faith. And so faith is so important to the Lord. That we don't just see what we see with our eyes, but we take spiritual eyes to know that he can do what he says that he can do, that his promises are true, and that we can hold on to them. So just gather that thing in your heart right now that you need to trust him for, and let's sing this together. Just build an altar, drench it in water, stand back and wonder, he'll start a fire. Nothing can stop him. There's no one like him. He holds all power. This is our God. Just build an altar, drench it in water, and stand back and wonder. He'll start a fire, 'cause nothing can stop him. Oh, there's no one like him. He holds all power. This is our God. Amen. Amen.
May I not forget the bloody shed. of Christ, I am alive.
Come on, church, can we boast? Can we boast in the Lord today? Give Him praise for what He's done and all that He's going to do. It's because of Him that we are alive. He's brought us from death and into life. And we're going to celebrate that through baptisms today. So why don't you turn your attention to the screen or right behind me.
Good morning, Harvest. It's great to be together. It's great to worship. My name is Larry. I'm one of the pastors here. We get to celebrate the work that God is doing in our church and in people's lives through baptism. And I'm here first with Fiona Godkey. All right, Fiona. Super excited for you. But can you just share with us a little bit, when did you decide to follow Jesus and declare Him as the Lord and Savior of your life?
When I was in fourth grade, I was doing an Awana question, and I accepted Him after that.
Yeah. Praise God. And so since then, since you said, I've realized I need Jesus, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, and I'm following Him, how has He been working in your life since that day? Sleep, that's important. We need that. Thank you, Jesus. And then, so you're here today in this baptism in front of all these people. Why do you want to get baptized?
I want to publicly profess my faith, and because Jesus says in the Bible that we shall be baptized, and I want to follow Him.
Praise God. That's great. All right, Fiona. Upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, this is Brianna Pekaski. Brianna, can you tell us and share with us when you decided to follow Jesus and declare Him as the Lord and Savior of your life?
It was actually at Camp Harvest one day, like on the last day. We all got some time, and I prayed to the Lord and confessed my sins.
Praise God, and now you're following Him. Amazing, and so since then, how has God been working in your life? What have you realized about Him? How has He changed you since that day?
I feel like I can do more because I trust Him more.
Right, because there's power in the name of Jesus. That's amazing. And you trust Him, not your own ability and your own strength. And so, same thing, you're here in front of all these people. Why do you want to be baptized today?
Because I feel like it's going to change my life forever.
That's right. And you're going to follow Jesus forever. Praise God. All right, well, Brianna, based on your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, this is Callie Keefe. Callie, when did you come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior and decide to follow?
So I grew up Catholic, so I always believed in God, but I didn't come to truly know Jesus until the summer before eighth grade. My best friend Sydney brought me to Camp Harvest, and shortly after that, I was saved.
Praise God.
Yes.
And, yep, praise God for that. Come on. And since then, how has God been working in your life?
I've been living more for God and not for the world, and not trying to conform to society, and just trying to be a light for other people like God is for me.
Praise God. That's good stuff. And so, why do you want to be baptized today, Callie?
To publicly proclaim my faith and solidify the foundation I've built in Jesus.
Come on. All right. Callie, it's upon your profession of faith. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. right, everybody, this is Barbara Joe. Barbara, can you just share with us when you decided to follow Jesus?
I want to say that I've always was raised Catholic. I always had an understanding of Christ. Never had a true relationship with him, though. It was one of my darkest moments that I acknowledged that I was a sinner and that I need Christ. And he's so good. And once I confessed my sins to God and asked him to forgive me, I asked him to become Lord and Savior of my heart.
Praise God.
Yeah. Jesus, he's so sweet. It's awesome to live with him and for him.
That's right.
And I just want to say that he's changed my life for the better. And I feel like the Holy Spirit has ignited my life. And I want to just live for him.
Amazing. So glad you found him. He found you. And so since then, how has Jesus been working in your life? How has he been changing you?
Yeah, he's changed my heart of stone, honestly, to a heart of flesh. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Mm-hmm. I want the world to see Jesus through me.
And so, Barbara, why do you want to be baptized?
I want to proclaim that I'm a follower of Jesus Christ to the world.
Yeah. Come on, that's great. Okay, Barbara, it's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, everybody, this is Winston Lewis. Winston, can you share with everybody when you found Jesus, when you decided to follow him and make him Lord and Savior of your life?
When my sisters asked me when I wanted to join Mount and Clear, I just kept more learning him and learning.
Yeah. You decided you needed to follow him. You needed him to save you, right?
Yep.
That's right. So, Winston, how has God been working in your life and changing you since then?
Ever since that time, I've just been more and more confident in everything I do.
That's so good. Because Jesus is your strength, right?
Yes.
That's right. So why do you want to be baptized today?
To publicly confess that I'm a believer.
That's right. Well, we're going to do that. Come on. Winston, it's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond to this.
Fulfill the law.
Fade away except you, Jesus. And Lord, you are worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our lives. Lord, we exalt you here in this place. We magnify you. We glorify you. We give you all the praise. We give you all of the glory in this place. And in Jesus' mighty name, the church said, amen. Amen. Come on, church, can we give him praise for all that he's doing through the baptisms? We love you, Jesus. Amen. Hey, we're going to enter into a time of the message. But before we do, why don't you say hello to someone around you?
You know those big things in life? Marriage, family, kids, friendship, work, faith. They're so important, you carve out time to think about them because they make life full, abundant. But what about your money? Who do you talk to about that? You might have financial advisors, estate advisors, tax advisors, even culture telling you why money's important. But what if they don't have the full story? Like how money shapes your heart, shapes your family, shapes your life. How money gives us the opportunity to be generous, and how deep down we all know the beauty of generosity, how it transforms people and connects us to the heart of our generous God. For God so loved the world that he gave. How it brings freedom and joy, and how you've never really met an unhappy, generous person. And so it makes sense to spend time with people who love generosity, to think about it deeply and to talk about it honestly. But here's the problem. It's tough because most people who want to talk about generosity seem to have an agenda. They want something from you. So who can you really talk to? Believe it or not, there are others like you who realize we need to talk about generosity more, not less, because generosity is connected to the abundant life. So a few of us are gathering together, and here's the thing. It's all fully and privately funded. So you'll never get asked for money ever. And this is really important because we all know that in order to be open and honest, it has to be safe. We don't assume to know what's right for you, only that God has blessed you and that your life is unique. But that doesn't mean you're alone. So here's our agenda. We want your heart to be captured by Jesus and generosity even more. and create a place where you figure out what that means for your journey, and that's it. At Generous Giving, we don't want something from you. We want something for you, to go deeper and to experience a life that is truly life. So we invite you, carve out one day this year to explore generosity with others like you. You're invited to a journey of generosity. Generousgiving.org.
Hi, it's good to see you. Thanks. If you're in junior high school, I was just informed that I need to dismiss you. I don't know to where or why, but I was told you can go to wherever it is that you go during these hours. And if you're new here and you're in junior high and you're wondering what that is, you just follow these small people out to whatever it is that they're doing. Okay, you guys have a good time. Hey, wait, you're not in junior high. Just kidding. I also want to, just quickly, that little video that we just showed a second ago, one of the weird things about being a pastor is that you're thrust into these odd situations where you are called to disciple people, and one of the biggest areas of discipleship for us is money. And yet, in our world today, as soon as you start talking about it, everybody thinks it's self-serving because you're like, oh, you just want money for the church. And so I get it, because there's been so many bad examples in the church. Everyone gets cynical about it. So we're trying to navigate some of that. So one of the things we want to do is we think one of the big pieces of discipleship, especially for Harvest in the coming years, is that we want to be more generous. And that's not just generous to Harvest Bible Chapel. It's generous generally in everything we do. And so we're trying to foster some of that. And so it's a Friday night and Saturday morning. We ran a test case with the program with some of our staff who were decidedly cynical before we went in. Oh, great, you guys just want to raise money. But we really just wanted to talk about what the scriptures have to teach about generosity in general, about the way our lives should be postured toward other people and what hospitality genuinely looks like. And so we went through it, they raved about it, and we thought this is the kind of thing that would be really valuable for our entire congregation. And so Saturday night, I think it's September 6th, Friday night, December 6th. I'm not feeling well. I want you to know that ahead of time, right? I think I've got something going on, so my brain is stopping. But September 6th, Friday night, September 7th, Saturday morning, we have a little program. We got kids ministry and stuff. They'll be happening during that time. You can bring your kids. They can go and hang out and learn some stuff as well, and you can come here, and you can connect with people at all the other campuses as well. We will have each one of the campuses has it going on as well, and so you can come and be a part of that. You really will be thankful for it. It will give you a lot of hope in your heart and a lot of release from the kinds of worries and things that trouble us a lot of times when it comes with money, because our Lord's got lots of it, and he wants to use us to bless his world with it, okay? And that's really ultimately what we want to be. So, recommend it to you. You can find out all the information at harvestbiblechapel.org. Awkwardly, I now get to talk about giving to the church. That was not planned. But part of the way that we worship every week is through giving. There, we put a slide up behind me, repeated every week. There's a QR code there that if you like to give electronically, you can click on that. You can give through our app. There are little blue boxes at the back of the room too. So as you leave, we don't pass the plate, but if as you leave, you can drop whatever gift you have in there. I will say that if you are new with us here, it is awesome to have you, and I just want you to know your presence here is gift enough. There is no reason at all for you to have to give here. Let us give to you for a while. If you're a part of Harvest Bible Chapel, you call this your home. We've got to pay for the lights and my new Bentley. So I'm kidding. I don't have a Bentley. I have a Mazda. But we would really love for you to just lean in and be a part of what we're doing here, okay? I want to pray for the offering. I want to pray for our time together in the Word. So if you'll join me, it'd be great. Lord, I'm thankful for your grace, and I'm thankful for your love for us. I'm thankful for the blessings you've laid upon us. I think about all the different ways. I mean, if we just sat here for a minute or two and we reflected, as we often should, on what you've done for us in our lives and the ways that you have gifted us, it's overflowing. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that knowledge would move us to give, even in the leanest times, even in the times where it's not, we're not sure. Lord, giving back to you a portion of what you've given to us is the right thing to do. So God, I pray that you find us faithful in that act. Would you bless the money that is brought in at Harvest, that you use it for your work, Father, that you'd find us faithful in stewarding it well. We know you're going to hold us all accountable for every last penny. So God, I pray that you would help the leadership of the church and others to be really critical with themselves regarding what they're spending on and how we can best multiply it to see churches planted all over the place and people come to faith in Christ and your kingdom grow in all sorts of places. Lord, I'm going to also ask that you would open our hearts and our minds now as we study your word. I pray, Lord, for the people in the room who are dealing with some difficult moments. This book, Habakkuk, is like a salve in the wound, right? I mean, it's healing for us. So I pray, Lord, that would be the effect. Spirit, would you come? Would you use me to be faithful to teach what this passage has to say? And ultimately, I pray that if there's anything I'm going to say here that is not of you, you just shut me up before it starts. And I pray, ultimately, Lord, that you would be glorified by everything that happens in the next few minutes. So we're waiting for you, Lord. Come, teach us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. One of the hardest conversations I've ever had in my life was actually with an intern at my old church. He was probably 19 years old at the time. He had showed an interest in going into ministry. His father had been on the elder board, so he had a kind of a front row seat to seeing the effects of leadership on a family. It didn't scare him off. Connor was really committed. He had a girlfriend, and they were planning on getting married soon. He's going to ask her. I'd preached this sermon at Saturday night at the church, and I'd gone upstairs into our offices, which had big plate glass windows looking out onto the darkness, and I was sitting there changing things for the next day, right? Because sermons are never finished, they're only ever abandoned, so you just keep working on them. And he wandered over to my corner of the office. There's nobody else in there. It was quite a large room. We had an open office, quite a large room, and no lights on. And he sat down across from me, just not something that he normally did. And I said, "Hi, Connor, what's up?" He said, "I was wondering if I could ask you a question." And I said, "Sure." He said, "I don't know if you know this, but I was diagnosed this week with a pretty aggressive cancer." Now, I did know that. I had been told through the grapevine. I'd actually prayed for Connor before that moment, but I asked a few questions about it and what the prognosis was. It was not good. He was going to go get treatment. 19 years old, all these big plans. He said, you know, I want to marry my girlfriend. You know that I want to go into ministry. You know that I really feel like for the first time in my life, I've got a vision for my future and what it is that I'm supposed to be doing. And I really want to honor God with it. But I have a question after the events of this week, learning about my prognosis. Why doesn't God better look after his servants? Like, if I want to be committed to him and I want to do all of these particular things to try to help and serve him, I don't understand why he would do this. I'm struggling so much. I'm up at night. And it's not the cancer that I'm struggling with, you know, so much. It's the why. Why now? Why me? It's not the first time I've heard that question. They should have a whole class on it at seminary. Why? Chuck Swindoll, great preacher of years gone by, said it well. He said, of all questions, this is the most searching, the most tormenting. It accompanies every tragedy. It falls from the lips of the mother who delivers a stillborn, the wife who learns of her husband's tragic death, the child who is told daddy won't be coming home anymore, the struggling father of five who loses his job, the close friend of one who commits suicide. Why? Why me? Why now? Why this? Nothing can fully prepare us for such moments, and few thoughts can steady us afterward. If you've lived long enough, you've probably at one point or another wanted to have a conversation with God where that is the subject that you discuss. Why? That's such a compelling idea that people have written books about it. There's one a number of years ago called The Shack, which was about a guy who went up into a shack and met God there. He'd lost his family member, and so he had questions about why God allows such things to happen, and he has a meeting with God, and the book is basically about this meeting with God. It's not a great discussion, which is sad, quite honestly, because he didn't need to write it. He could have just gone to Habakkuk, because that's what the book is about. It's a conversation between God and Habakkuk, where Habakkuk is dealing with the problem of evil. He's trying to say, Lord, I don't understand how it is that you have permitted evil and evil people and injustice to constantly come up before us. In his particular situation, the people of Israel were being oppressed or were going to be taken over by another nation, the Babylonians in this case, and he's trying to figure out why. Don't you know that the Babylonians are wicked? Don't you know? Like, they're the Nazis. Why are you allowing the Nazis to have some level of success in this world if you're good and righteous? What is going on? In fact, the beginning of the book of Habakkuk, the first few verses are really telling. He says, oh Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you won't hear? You ever felt that? This stuff of this earth, like cancer and injustice and slave trading and sexual immorality, all of this stuff, Lord, doesn't belong. You don't want it here. Why don't you do away with it? Oh, Lord, how long shall I cry? I'm the one crying out for help, but it seems like it's just bouncing off the ceiling when I say the words. How long? Or I cry out to you, violence, because that's what it is. I see all these things happening. It's just straight violent. And you won't save. Why do you make me see iniquity? And why do you idly look at wrong? You're just sitting on your hands. You say you can do something about it, then do something about it. Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed. This law that you gave your people that's supposed to drive our lives and give a testimony to the world and show that you are righteous and just. It's paralyzed. Justice never goes forth, for the wicked surround the righteous, so justice goes forth perverted. Why is the world the way it is? And more importantly, how in the world are we supposed to live in the midst of this tension? How do we find a place of rest? Can you find a place of rest? Or is it just always going to be anxiety? No surety, no place where we can just relax. Because we're always worried that violence is going to come and affect us in some another way. And I mean by violence from others and violence from disease and violence from all the things. The beauty of the book of Habakkuk is actually his answer is, yeah, there is a place of rest. And so here's what I want to do in the next few minutes. I want to show you that there is one, that he finds a place of rest. But then I want to show you two ways to get there. Because the book will give two ways to get there. And I want to do that through studying actually the last chapter, Habakkuk chapter 3. But I want to start Habakkuk chapter 3 at the end of Habakkuk chapter 3, and then we'll come to the beginning. Because I want to contrast what I just read. How long, O Lord, why have you don't you listen? Why do you sit idly by? I want to contrast that with the way the book ends. The accusations at the beginning of God, you're not doing anything, and this is terrible, and I've got crisis in my own heart over it, with the end, which describes a place to rest. Here's what he says. These are the last verses of the book. Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. You guys see all of the language, right? It's all about an agrarian society, flocks and herds. And he's describing complete and utter devastation and barrenness. See, the way that it worked in those days, and certainly even today, if you're a farmer, one of the things that farmers usually are is religious. You know that? It's that you don't really find a lot of atheistic farmers. And the reason is because you're so close to relying upon the weather. And you'd have no control over the weather. And so no matter where you are in the world today, if you are involved in some kind of farming, you are involved in some kind of religion because you're appealing to a higher power to deliver you from the barrenness. You need the rain. You don't need the hail. You don't want the sun to get too high. So you have to appeal to the gods. Now, that's the way it was in these days, no matter who you were. You appealed to the gods to provide for you the rain and all of those sorts of things. And the job of the gods, this is why you go and you do your worship, right? You bring all your gifts to the gods. The job of the gods was to respond to your worship by giving you production or giving you prosperity of some variety. What this is describing, though, is the failure on the part of the God. Because he's supposed to provide a flourishing fig tree, a blossoming one, a fruit on the vines. He's supposed to provide produce of the olive, but he's saying that none of that is happening. So though none of that is happening, in other words, everything is going wrong and everything is terrible in my life. I actually wrote a while ago, a modern equivalent to what he writes here. Though my business is failing, though a doctor says there's no cure, though creditors are calling for immediate repayment, though there's constant pain and heartache, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. Okay, so I want whatever he's got. Yes? Isn't that what you want? More than anything else in your life right now is the ability to, in the worst of times, to say, I still praise you. Where your devotion to God and your attitude toward him and those around you is not dependent on the circumstance, it's only dependent on who he is and what you know to be true of him, so you're not swayed to and fro. And he's describing here that there is a place then to rest. You can have this. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I'll take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. This is a great line. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. And where I used to live and grew up in the Pacific Northwest, they have lots of mountains, and the deer there hop onto ledges, and they stand there. And I would never be able to keep my feet on those ledges. If I were standing on those ledges, I'd fall off immediately. I don't have great balance to begin with, but I would be falling off. And so the language he's using here is trying to say sure-footed. It's the thing about a deer is they're very sure-footed. They don't fall over very much. They can bounce and get their little feet on a location and just sort of stand. If you've ever seen mountain goats, they're like that. You see pictures of people walking and hiking, and up on the above them on a little ledge is a mountain goat. Well, that's the picture that he's drawing on. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on high places. In other words, there is a way for you to be in the midst of cliffs and find your footing. There is a place of rest that you can have. You can sit in the eye of the hurricane. Whenever I think about that idea of a place of rest, my mind is always drawn back to Horatio Spafford, who was an old Christian man who wrote many, many songs, a very famous one that you know. You probably don't know the story behind his song, his famous song, though. Here's how that goes. Horatio Spafford was a prominent, successful businessman in Chicago in the mid-19th century. He'd enjoyed great success. He was wealthy, well-known, influential. But overnight, he lost almost everything. The Great Chicago Fire left him in near financial ruin. So he decided to relocate his family. At 2 in the morning, November 22nd, 1873, he loaded his wife and four daughters onto a French luxury liner and kissed them goodbye, promising to meet them in France as soon as he could settle his business affairs. Several days out of port, that luxurious ship, sailing peacefully toward France, was rammed by an English ship, and it took only 2 hours for the boat to sink to the ocean floor. 226 people died on that ship, including all four of Horatio Spafford's daughters. 9 days later, when the survivors landed safely at Cardiff, Wales, Spafford received a short wire from his wife. It just contained two words: saved, alone. As soon as possible, he booked passage on a ship to Europe to join his wife. On the way over, the captain called Spafford to the bridge of the ship and said, "Our instruments indicate we're now passing over the place where your children drowned." Spafford thanked the captain, went back to his cabin, and then he wrote these lines: "When peace, like a river, attendeth my way, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul." So how do you get that? How do you hover over the hardest moments of your entire life in the midst of the storm and find the eye? How do you get to the place where you can be on the high places like a deer? When everything else is going sideways and bad and wrong, yet you will rejoice in the Lord, for he is your strength. Well, Habakkuk actually gives the answer to that in two stages. There's two things he identifies that you got to do if you're going to find that place. They are, one, you got to remember the God of the past. And second, you got to hope in the God of the future. You got to remember the God of the past and then hope in the God of the future. So let me show you what I mean by that, I mean to remember the God of the past. So let's go back. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 1, right? So I dealt with the end and the place that he got to, but how did he get there? Here's how he did. A prayer of Habakkuk, the prophet. Remember I told you this is a conversation, the whole book is a conversation to him and God. He has these accusations about life and things, how hard life is, and God then responds. And then Habakkuk responds, and then God responds, and then we finally get to the end, and Habakkuk prays. So this is his prayer in the end, a prayer of Habakkuk the prophet according to Shigionoth. Isn't that a great name? You should name your kids that, Shigionoth. Some of you love biblical names, right? There it is. You know, it's funny, nobody knows what that, I mean, I'm sure somebody knows what it means, but it's the big debate among scholars what Shigionoth means. It's probably just a way for you to read the poem. You know how sometimes people write a song and they'll say, and it's in 3/4 time. And again, I don't know if that's a thing or not. I just said 3/4 because that sounds about right to me. Okay? I don't know how to do music. So he's probably telling you this is the way that you're supposed to read it. So here's the prayer. You're supposed to read it according to Shigionoth. Cool. Oh, Lord, I have heard the report of you and your work. Your work, O Lord, do I fear. I've heard about you. I mean, this is a prophet who's grown up in his little Hebrew house, and he's essentially saying, I remember sitting on the knee of my dad, and he would tell stories about you, Lord, and the things that you have done in the past for our people. How it was that the biggest, most scary leader in the world, Pharaoh, taunted you, and you went 10 rounds against him, wiped him out, and then took the people across the Red Sea, burying the biggest army in the world at the time under the waves. I remember that. I remember my dad's face glowing when he would talk about how his God saved his people. About how Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went into the fiery furnace, but didn't burn. About how Daniel closed the mouths of the lions. About how the ark was stolen by the Philistines and it went all by itself. There's nobody with it, but it went all by itself and they put it into the temple of Dagon, the rival god. And Dagon the next morning was found with his face down, bowing before the ark. And they propped him back up and then they closed the door. And then the next morning they found Dagon bowed down, but this time his hands were cut off and his head was cut off. All by yourself, God, you did that. I remember my dad talking, God doesn't need anyone. He called us out and he made us his own, and all the stories of the ways that you've acted. I've heard the report of you and your work, O Lord, do I fear. In the midst of the years, though, revive it. This is a kind of a clunky translation of this. He's basically saying, could you do it in our day? I've heard about it in the past, but could you show it now? In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. And so what he's going to do here in a minute is he's going to basically talk about, it's a poem, it's a song where he starts singing about what God has done in the past, specifically when he brought his people out of Egypt. God came from Teman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran. You all know where those are, right? No, nobody does. Of course, what he means is God came from the east. What happens every morning in the east? I wouldn't know, I'm never up early enough, but for those of you who are, I've been told the sun comes up from the east. And that's what God came from Teman and the Holy One from Mount Paran. His splendor covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise. He's trying to say that God is like the sun that rises. See this language? His brightness was like the light. Rays flashed from his hand, and there he veiled his power. So early in the morning, you see the sun rise, and it's all supposedly all dark, but then the sun rises, and the light just covers everything. Have you ever seen, there was actually a factory that exploded in Lebanon like 4 or 5 years ago, and there's a video online of this guy who's in a boat off the coast, and the explosion happens, and then there's this wave that starts coming for him, and it's a video. He's like, I'm out of here, and he jumps in the water, and his camera is showing up above, and the wave goes over the top of him. This is the image that he's after. He's saying the light of God. When the Lord showed up in the days gone by, when his people were in great difficulty, and then the Lord showed up, his presence just was like a blast wave that just flattened everything in its path. Before him went pestilence and plague followed at his heel. He stood at the measure of the earth and measured the earth. He looked and shook the nations. The eternal mountains were scattered. Isn't that great? The eternal mountains, those things that have been around forever, were like, oh, the Lord's coming. We're out of here. The everlasting hills sank low. His were the everlasting ways. I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction. The curtains of the land of Midian did tremble. These curtains and these tents were supposedly the biggest barriers that there were in the day, that these nations that were really strong, this just melt before the Lord. There's usually a scene in the monster movies where the monster is revealed, right? Do you guys like the monster movies? Yeah? No? Okay, they're fun. Right? Godzilla or some of the others. There was one, Cloverfield, a number of years ago. What's interesting, if you're gonna film a monster movie, though, you never show the monster, like, in the first scene. Do you know? Like, hey, let's get a good tight shot of Godzilla's face. No. No, you got to build up to Godzilla's face. What you usually do is see the people in the dark hallway, and they've got the peering light from their flashlights, and they're trying to look, and it's all dusty and hazy, and then all of a sudden their flashlight scans the room, and then there's this creature that goes right across the front, and that's when my wife says, we're leaving, right? I'm not watching this movie. But then, as the movie goes on, you see the back side of the creature, and then you see the leg of the creature, and then you see the arm of the creature, and it's building until finally, he rises up, Godzilla. And everybody in his path runs. This is what Habakkuk is saying, is that when the Lord showed up, and he judged the people, and he delivered from the people from Egypt. Nobody stood in his way. And then he put the people in the promised land. There was no nation. The walls of Jericho didn't matter. I don't care how powerful the kings were. It didn't matter. They melted right over. When the Lord showed up, was it your wrath against the rivers, O Lord? Was your anger against the rivers or your indignation against the sea? When you rode on your horses, on your chariot of salvation, he's in modern language. When you took out the tank, you're leading the way. William Wallace, Braveheart, freedom! This is the picture. You stripped the sheath from your bow. you unholstered your weapon. Calling for many arrows. You split the earth with rivers. The mountains saw you and writhed. Isn't that great? They writhed. The mountains saw you, right? Talk about the biggest barrier that stands in your way are the mountains. You guys know what mountains are? You've seen them before. But you go to a massive mountain, you're like, well, it's going to be hard to get over that. But when the Lord shows up, nope. It's just shivering on the ground. The raging waters swept on. The deep gave forth its voice. This is such a complicated way of saying that. The deep gave forth this voice. It's talking about the sea, right? The sea started squealing. It lifted its hands on high. I give up. The sun and moon stood still in their place at the light of your arrows as they sped at the flash of your glittering spear. You marched through the earth in fury. You threshed the nations in anger, the way that you used to, the way that they used to have to like get grain from the stalk of wheat was that you took the wheat stalk and you put it on the ground with a bunch of other wheat stalks, and then you would take something really heavy like a big stone and you bash it repeatedly, right? Or you I Love Lucy'd it with your feet, you know? Remember the grapes? That's a really dated reference, but for some of you, you'd... That's what he's saying, though, that the nations, I just want you to think about that, right? The nations, Justin Trudeau and you know, sorry, he's particularly the one that's coming to mind when I think about people stepping on someone. But you threshed the nations in your anger, and the Lord showed up. There's no king. There's no ruler. There's a Putin. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You went out for the salvation of your people, for the salvation of your anointed. You crushed the head of the house of the wicked, laying him bare from thigh to neck. Ugh. You pierced with his own arrows the heads of his warriors who came like a whirlwind to scatter me, rejoicing as if to devour the poor in secret. And you trampled the sea with your horses, the surging of mighty waters. The song is essentially just about how when the Lord shows up, he comes as a mighty warrior. And the story in the past have been of the Lord, the people being in great danger and difficulty, and the Lord showing up. And when the Lord shows up, it's not like when Batman shows up. Do you know Batman? I can't stand Batman. You know why? Because Batman's always getting beat up, right? I don't like Batman getting beat up. I want my heroes Jason Bourne or, you know, Equalizer, where he's got a watch and he just puts it down there, you know? And he says, you know, Denzel's like, oh, you got 10 seconds and then you're all done, right? I want my champions to not be touchable. And that's what the Lord is in this case. He's not going to get punched. He's indestructible. He's the one who in the past has come and delivered, and he has all power and all ability to do it at every place. So here's the big point he's trying to make. If we want to find peace in a storm, we need to remember God has conquered storms before. And when he has conquered the storms before, then there's been no question about his ability to do it. The reason he's talking about the history of Israel is he's saying, like, we're facing a real challenge here. My situation stinks right now. But God has faced stinky situations before. And he's always delivered me through it. He always has brought me where he wants me. He's got a remarkable track record with me. Track record is everything, right? I think I've told you before that my oldest son, he came home one day and his teacher had taught him how to do the trust fall. And he came home and he's, Dad, let's do the trust fall. And I wasn't paying attention. I don't know. He says a lot of things, right? Oh, he stood there and he's like, okay, here I come. And he came back. I was looking off at something in the distance. I didn't even try. I actually think it would have been a pretty funny video because my oldest son, trusting his father who loves him, I love you, son. And then he's standing there and he's like, and he goes straight back, and I just watched him. And he landed at my feet, broke his arm. He broke his arm. My bad. It was funny, too, because he was on my baseball team at the time, and he broke his right arm, and I was like, you got another one? And so I actually still made him play, but he was hitting lefty. I have two more kids. They're way better. Right. Anyway, it's funny because this is a story that's gone around in my family. The fact that Dad, don't do trust falls with Dad. Well, my second son, 3 years younger, goes and he has the same class 3 years later, and he comes back. He's like, Dad, we learned the trust fall. I'm going to do a trust fall. And he's standing there, and you should have seen my oldest son, Ethan, was like, Micah, don't! You know, don't do it. He won't catch you. Micah's looking around, what do you mean he won't catch you? He's my father, and he loves me. And I'm like, yeah, I don't know, man. I'm probably not going to catch you. Right? Because that's what you do when someone lets you down or something goes sideways or whatever. The track record is established, right? Even if I had done the trust fall with like another 9 people, I'm 9 out of 10 on the trust fall. You'd be like, yeah, it's 90%. I need 100% on the trust fall, right? And that's what you want. You want a track record. When you're dealing with the biggest things in your life, when you go in and you want to get the doctor is gonna you know, fix you up, you did something wrong, or they found something inside of you, what you don't want is, I've never seen that before. I don't know what that is. Do you know? I went online and I was Googling it, but I couldn't figure it out. What you want is the old guy who's been there, crotchety dude, who's seen everything. I've got these on my shelf, you know? I've done 1,000 of these, and I'm 1,000 for 1,000. Give me that doctor. Because I want the one who's got the track record. I trust people who've got 100% track record. The Lord is not a 90% God with you. He's 100% God with you. He's not 90% faithful with you. He's 100% faithful. He's not 90% provision for you. He's 100% provision. At the moment, you might have thought, no, he's 90. He's not going to come through. But then some weird way, he came through. And the way he came through was majestically better than the way that you thought he was going to come through. And so then you stand there and you're like, whoa, what a God I serve. But then 10 minutes later, like every other disciple in the history of the world, 10 minutes later, you're facing another challenge and you're like, I don't know if you're going to provide. Yes, he's 100%. He's always done it. He will always do it. Just think about your own life. Seriously, just think about your own life. Hasn't he fought for you? Hasn't he provided for you? Hasn't he done the most amazing things? He surprised you by his power to work all things for your good. So look, if you want to have a moment of rest, a place in the eye of the hurricane, you need to realize that the God that has you in the palm of his hand and holds you tightly there and says, this one is mine and I will never let go, this God has the power over even the hurricane. He's the weatherman, and he can take care of everything. So, worry about the weather. Just worry about the Lord. So step one, you got to remember the God of the past. The last part of this passage is really, okay, then take the knowledge that you have of the God of the past, attach it to the idea that this God is not changing. It's one of his character traits, that he's immutable. He does not change like you and I change. He is not going to tomorrow figure something out and go, well, that is an epiphany. He knows all. He is perfect, has always been perfect. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Therefore, the God of the past who has acted that way in the past and has been faithful in the past is guaranteed to be faithful in the future. So remember the God of the past and then put your hope in the God of the future who's the same God as the past. You find the end of this passage here. He said, he responds, I hear. So all of this description of God and his power, I hear and my body trembles. But he's not trembling here at the description of God. He's trembling at the circumstances. My body trembles, my lips quiver at the sound, rottenness enters my bones, and my legs tremble beneath me. Isn't that what it feels like when everything's going wrong and that you don't, and evil is coming upon you, whether in the form of cancer or some oppressor? I don't know if I can stand up, Lord. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon people who invade us. I will wait for the Lord to come and deliver us. I will wait for the Lord to follow through on what he has said that he is going to do in my life and the lives of every Christian who's ever lived. I will wait. I will wait quietly. Not complaining, not freaking out. I'm going to sit in the eye of that hurricane with full knowledge that the hurricane is around me, and I am going to wait. You know, I think every few months, this is a passage that we should read together as a church. This is kind of as we finish here. It is Revelation 21. It's the end of the book, right? So you take your Bible, you go to the end because you want to find out what's going to happen. Here's the end of the book. Revelation 21, you'll hear me read this passage over and over again so it sinks into your mind and heart. Then I saw a new heaven and new earth, for the first heaven and first earth had passed away and the sea was no more. And I saw a holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." And he who is seated on the throne said, "Behold, I'm making all things new." Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life." Are you thirsty? "I'll give it without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." In other words, what he's saying is that the God who has come both in judgment and blessing, because that's when the Lord comes, that's what happens. He brings judgment upon the wicked and he brings blessing upon the righteous. The problem is all of us are wicked except those who are in Christ and have received his righteousness. So when the Lord comes, the righteous that he will find are these Christian people who aren't righteous in and of themselves, but are righteous in Christ. And everyone else will be judged. And that's good news. I know we don't like to talk about it that way. The good news is not just that we're in Christ and we won't receive the judgment that God brings upon all. The good news is that God will deal with injustice. He'll make all things new. He will put the world to rights. And that knowledge that you and I inhabit a world of injustice right now, but the just God will come and he will judge it, just like he always has. He will bless those who are in him, and then he will judge the world. Gives us so much hope in the midst of difficulty. It's not like, oh, there's no answers to the injustice of the world. It's just wait. Just wait. You know that when when the slaves were out in the fields in the United States in its early years there, when the slaves were out of the fields, they actually developed a form of music that we still sing some places. They're called the old Negro spirituals. They're phenomenal songs. Do you know what they're about? Like, have you ever stopped and listened to the words of the old Negro spirituals? You know some of them, right? "Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home." "I looked over Jordan and what did I see? Coming for to carry me home. A band of angels coming after me, coming for to carry me home." Don't you? They're singing in the midst of one of the most ridiculous moments in the history of the world. The slavery and the oppression and the dehumanization that took place in that whole thing. They're singing songs about the deliverance. that will come. So how do they keep going? How do they get up every day and keep going? Well, because they know that there's a day where the Lord will come and he will deliver his people, and they are them. We have a glorious future. Evil will be judged. Now is all that there is. So one of my favorite stories, this is the last thing I want to say to you, okay? One of my favorite stories is actually about a guy named Charles Simeon. He was a pastor of a church in England. And he was an evangelical pastor back in the days when that was an uncommon thing. Evangelical meaning that he believed in the gospel of free grace. He believed that you couldn't earn anything before God, that the only person who earned anything before God was Jesus. And therefore, those who are in him by faith and faith alone stand before God righteous. So he would preach this. He would preach this. Well, in those days, if you went to a church, and you can do this today, by the way, if you ever want to go up into Boston and go on the Freedom Trail, it takes you into certain churches up there, and you can see the way churches used to be. They used to be in little boxes, right? So the pastor would be here, and then there'd be a box, and around the edge of the box would be like a bench seat. So you'd have a family box. It's like going to the Cubs, right? And each family would own the box because they would give certain money to the church, and that would get you a box. And if you gave more money, you'd be in this section. And if you didn't, you'd be over there. And, right? So everybody had a box. Well, the people of his church didn't like him preaching this grace stuff. So what they did is they ended up closing their boxes and locking the doors. You had a little key and you could lock the little door to the box. I mean, you could jump over, I guess, but this wasn't that kind of day. So they'd locked their boxes. And so if you stood on the stage and you were about to preach, the church was empty. All the seating areas were empty. Do you know where he would seat people? He'd go out and he'd get chairs and he'd seat them in the aisles. That's the only thing he would do. 10 years of his life at this church, the first 10 years, that's what church was for him. Standing in front of the people, preaching the gospel, and half the people in the town hated him, didn't want to do anything, and they paid him back by locking their pews. He used to pray, he was an amazing guy, he used to pray, Lord, look, if the church were normal and these seats were filled, we'd have like, 300, but I can only fill 150 into the aisles, so if you give them a double blessing this morning, it'll be just like none of this ever happened. 10 years this man kept preaching. Dude, if you write me an email that I don't like, I'm like, I'm going home now, But he kept going, Charles Simeon. Anyway, he gets to the end of his ministry, and so these other pastors eventually write him. This dude was in his church for like 49 years, 50 years, something like that. And they write him, dude, how did you last? How did you last this long? In the midst of all this sorrow and heartache, here's what he said. His response in letter to another pastor was this. He said, my dear brother, we must not mind a little suffering for Christ's sake. When I'm getting through a hedge, if my head and shoulders are safely through, I can bear the pricking of my legs. Let us rejoice in the remembrance that our holy head has surmounted all his suffering and triumphed over death. Let us follow him patiently. We shall soon be partakers of his victory. How do you find the place of rest? You remember the God of the past. You know that he's the same God as the God of the future. And you keep your eyes dead set on him and not the things going on around you. You get out of the boat. And instead of looking at the wind and the waves, you look at the Jesus who stands on top of them. And you walk. Anyway, that's what I told Connor. Let me pray for us. Father, I'm thankful for your grace. I'm thankful for your goodness to us. I pray that you would help us to I don't know all the circumstances that are going on in the lives of the dear people here. We face difficulty and heartache in many different ways, but Lord, I'm going to pray that you, by your Spirit, you're able to come and you're able to comfort us. You say they're a great comforter. Would you come and you comfort our hearts with the knowledge that our God can. Our God can. And he will. And I pray, Lord, I just want all of us in our mind's eye to move forward 1,000 years. And I pray, Lord, that we would know that this is a fleeting, very short period of time, Father, where the difficulties lie. But there is coming a world where you will make all things right and all things new. And I pray, Lord, that our eyes would be focused on you, your ability to do that, and your ability to hold us up in the midst of this time with an eye toward that time. So God, would you fill us with your Spirit and grant us peace, which is what we really want, Father, so that we can say it is well with our soul. Would you help us let go of all of our frustrations and all of our pain and heartache, Father, and our questions, and in the end, just kind of release them into the ether and trust, Lord, that you have the answers. And we can just walk forward in freedom because we know you've got it all sorted out. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Oh, we serve a faithful God. Perfect track record. Worship.
That's right. We serve a faithful God who's there with us in the midst of everything that we'll go through. Jeff encouraged us in the fact that God is there even when we don't see him. Do you guys know that, right? In the midst of the storms, and storms are guaranteed in life. He gives us so many examples throughout the scriptures. But we can be encouraged and we can have peace in the fact that God brought us through before. He's going to do it again, right? Because he's faithful. We just sung it. Many of you may need to sing that to yourself. We serve a faithful God who sees us. He will never leave us or forsake us. His track record is awesome. And you can take that to the bank for sure. Right? But if you're in the middle of the storm, it could be hard to hear these words that we're saying. So come and get some prayer today. We'll have people up front to pray for you. And if this is your first time joining us today, or if you're new to Harvest and I haven't had an opportunity to meet you yet, I'd love to meet you. I'm going to try to make it to the lobby before you do. But remember this, as we go out on mission for Jesus Christ this week, he is with us. In fact, he goes before us. He's faithful. And guys, remember that. And also remember that you are loved. Have a great week.